According to the Oxford Dictionary, the phrase useful idiot was termed by Lenin to mean useful tools. It could also be a term that the Dominion would assign to the Klingon Empire and the United Federation of Planets leading up to the conflict. Let's take a look at the Cardassians before the Dominion War. Now let me be absolutely clear. I am not saying that the Dominion War was caused by the Federation nor the Klingons. I am not blaming anything on them. The Cardassians made their choice, both the civilian and military entities within the government. However, nothing ever occurs in a vacuum. Every choice that is made will impact everything else, both the decision to act or not to act. But first, let's take a look at the Cardassians. The Cardassians found themselves in an area with, well, very poor resources. The only real way to grow was through expansion, and unlike the Federation, they decided to expand through military might. So the Cardassians would expand, taking system after system and draining that system of its resources. They would continue on, using their power to subjugate other species. This would include many like Bajor. So we already know that the mentality and the culture of the Cardassians played a huge part. But let's see how other galactic governments interacted with them. Let's consider one of the earliest confrontations with the United Federation of Planets and the chance that Starfleet could have had to make a difference. The Federation-Cardassian War, also known as the Border Wars, was a prolonged conflict between the United Federation of Planets and the Cardassian Union. I think this war honestly highlights how ineffective and incompetent the Federation was, which led to the Cardassians joining the Dominion. Let's take a look at Federation technology versus Cardassian technology and ship designs.
The pursuing ship is the Phoenix.
And the other?
It appears to be a Cardassian supply ship.
How would you know that?
We are able to make that determination.
You can read our transponder codes.
The important thing at the moment is that one of your ships may be in jeopardy. Mr. Worf, has there been any answer to our communication?
No, Captain.
Put out a repeating message in all subspace channels. Priority one communique. Break off your pursuit immediately.
Aye, sir.
Thomas said, you see, we are doing everything in our power to reach the Phoenix.
Yes, and accomplishing nothing, I'm sorry to say. Can you show me the location of our other ships?
Mr. Data.
There you see, we have a warship which could intercept the Phoenix before it's too late. If you will give us the transponder frequency. Or are you going to stand there while our ship is destroyed, Captain?
Sir, the Cardassian warship is moving on the Phoenix.
Mr. Data, overlay weapon ranges of the two ships.
The warship is 300,000 kilometers from the Phoenix. It is opening fire. The Phoenix has taken a direct hit. The Phoenix is beginning evasive maneuvers. It has positioned itself outside the weapons range of the opposing ship. The Phoenix has powered up both phasers and photon torpedoes. The Phoenix is firing photon torpedoes.
He has destroyed our warship.
Does the supply ship have any weapons?
They're limited. Certainly not enough to defeat a Nebula-class starship.
Sir, the Phoenix is firing on the...
So the Federation could read their transponders. Not exactly cutting-edge technology. And the Cardassians considered the Nebula-class to be a threat. The Nebula-class. Let's explore the Nebula-class, shall we? The armaments of a Nebula-class included a torpedo launcher on the secondary hull, and if they really wanted a fight, they really meant business, they'd have two hull torpedo launchers and two phaser positions on the forwardmost part of the primary and secondary hull. Wow, truly a juggernaut of epic proportions. If we contrast that against the Galaxy class, which had 10 to 11 phaser banks and up to two or more torpedo launchers, there's not really a contest. You can see why I find the Federation to be less than all that impressive. They barely built any Galaxy-class ships and used vessels like the Nebula-class starship to fight their wars. And let's remember, they came to a stalemate with the Cardassians. They utilized weaker ships to fight a war they could have won with more powerful ships, and they had the ability to make these more powerful ships. Brilliant. So instead of victory and more lives saved, they came to a stalemate, created what is basically a neutral zone, and helped with the birth of the Maquis. Had the Federation decided to actually build more Galaxy-class ships, or even start to build ships similar to the Defiant or Acura class, they might have been able to push the Cardassians back into their own space, or even prevented the Cardassians from being able to become a more powerful galactic government. And yeah, I get it. This is 2020 hindsight, sure. But you can't really sit there and defend the military might of the Federation, nor really say that it wasn't complicit in helping to cause the conditions that created the Dominion War. By choosing to not use the force that they had available, Cardassia was emboldened and continued to grow and expand. The Demilitarized Zone creates the Maquis, a terrorist organization that will plague the Cardassian Union all the way up to just right before the Dominion War. The next major note would be the Klingon-Cardassian War, a war brought on by the Dominion who had successfully infiltrated the Klingon Empire. The Klingons, fearing Dominion interference in Cardassian affairs, attack the Cardassian borders. The Cardassians take heavy losses in both military assets and internal infrastructure. The Maquis, of course, took advantage of this and attacked as well. The Maquis effectively pushed the Cardassian Union out of the Demilitarized Zone. The Klingons were brutally destroying the Cardassians, and the United Federation of Planets just talked. The Cardassians were only able to slow the Klingon Empire down by committing hit-and-run attacks. This would be another time that the United Federation of Planets had a choice. They could choose to assist the Cardassians, who were obviously under attack without due cause. They could assist their allies and destroy the Cardassians. And they chose to sit back and talk. They would assist some convoys, true, but it was too little too late. While the Federation certainly had the ability to help stem the tide, the Maquis and Klingons played their parts. Let's look at the opinion of Benjamin Sisko.
The Maquis were never much of a threat to the Federation, but we were a threat to you. We were a stain on your record, and you couldn't have that. Not when you were so busy measuring yourself for an admiral's uniform.
You want to blame me for what happened to the Maquis? Fine. Go ahead. Blame me. Blame Starfleet. Blame the Federation. Blame everyone except Michael Eddington.
The Maquis won its greatest victories under my leadership.
Your leadership. Your shining moment of glory. Michael Eddington gets to take off his gold uniform and play hero. That's what you always wanted, to lead troops in a glorious cause. Well, you had your chance. And look where you led them, right into their graves.
They died because I wasn't there when they needed me most. Because you put me in jail.
They died because you filled their heads with false hopes, sold them dreams of a military victory when what they needed was a negotiated peace.
We had the Cardassians on the run.
And they ran right into the arms of the Dominion. End of story.
It's honestly not surprising that the Cardassian Union would embrace the Dominion. The Dominion complemented their culture, at least from a PR perspective, but let's more consider the position of the Cardassian Union and the people in it. They were broken from war. They went from being a huge galactic power down to what effectively is a third world power. Prestige completely gone? The Dominion offered them a place at the table again, and a chance to bring vengeance on their enemies. It's not surprising that they took it. And again, the United Federation of Planets and Klingon Empire did not start the war. The Cardassian Union did make their own bed. But Starfleet and the Klingons had a choice. They could have stopped this. They could have stopped it at the border wars. They could have stopped it during the Cardassian-Klingon War. But they didn't. They chose to do what they always did. And ultimately, the entire quadrant paid the price. Hey guys, thanks for watching. I can't tell you how cool and awesome it is to have so many people just be so interested in all of this lore and going through it, debating, seeing what we can come up with, and just taking a retrospective on the fiction that we love. Hey, if you want to continue to help me do this, consider becoming a patron. You can join as low as $2 a month, and there are all kinds of advantages. Now, before anyone gets upset, there are no paywalls. Whatever is free will continue to stay free. It just gives you a way of interacting with me and helping out, and you can do requests that everyone will get the advantage of. And on that note, I want to give a special shout out to David Drukin and Silent Gamer, my two current patrons. Thank you guys so much. Hey, if you're watching this, thank you for watching. Please don't forget to rate, comment, and subscribe, and I will see you on the next Lore Reloaded.